All right, so I wanted to just start off with a little bit of a look ahead at the next 2 weeks, because we don't have too many more classes left. So I'm kind of going to give you an overview. We have two big things to finish up this class. And I say big because they're kind of big, but I don't want you to stress out about them either, because you've been working towards these already for more than 10 weeks, I think. So one thing is the business plan, which is a written document that you guys will type and send to me by email. In our syllabus, it says that the final business plan is due next Wednesday, so a week from today. But I think it would be really helpful if you could send it to me before next Wednesday so that we can help you with edits. We have two writing mentors. Jane is one of our writing mentors, so she's here to help actually make it sound better, make the writing better. And that's just for your own benefit. It's not even for your grade, because you don't really get grades in this class. And then Jody Roth, who broke her ankle early in January, so she couldn't actually come to any of our classes, but she's standing by, ready to help editing. So one thing is the written document. And so you're going to use that worksheet outline that you have in your packets that gives you the headings and everything, and you're going to work off of that to fill in your business plan. And then at the end, you're going to have the financials. So you're going to have the executive summary, the description of business, target market, competition, team, and skills. And then you're going to have a startup expenses and budget. And so it would be good to make them look clean and easy to read like this. And it can be in a table format. That's probably best. But if you need to have notes or something, you can also have a paragraph about those startup expenses and budgets, if you need to explain something about those tables. But the idea of the tables is that they should be kind of self-explanatory, so that somebody who's interested in your business can just look at them and say, oh, I understand what's going on here financially, and I really think it's going to be a success. Or, oh, there's something that doesn't make sense here. And you know, so you want to make sure it's easy to read and kind of for somebody who doesn't know your business plan already. So that's the business plan. So I would like you to send them to me by Monday next week. And consider that the final draft, but I might send you back some edits, because I'm going to send those drafts to the writing mentors. In order to get ready for that, I suggest that you guys all work with your mentors over the next coming week, so that you can basically run it by them and see what their input is. So all of your mentors are here today, and you can make sure that you get their contact info so that you can either meet in person at a coffee shop, or talk on the phone, or exchange emails. So that's the one thing. Then the other thing is April 12th, so in 2 weeks, we're gonna have our Entry to Entrepreneurship Showcase, which is the culminating event for this program, and it's really a celebration of you guys and of everybody that makes this program possible. So it's a way that we can all hear what you've been working on, and then applaud you and actually give you 200 Berkshires each. And for the public, so the people who have sponsored this program, your parents, your friends, to see what you've been doing. And then if they're interested, then maybe say, oh, you know what, Carla, I know a lot about coffee shops and I want to help you. Or Keely, I want to be your client. Or so it could be whatever kind of your business needs. Like if your business needs customers, if your business needs maybe further support to make it even a better business plan before you launch, your presentation is kind of aimed at getting that. Whatever it is your business needs, maybe you need investment. So then your presentation can kind of be aimed at getting investors interested. So think about what your need is, and then when you're making your presentation, when you're preparing it, try to think about how your presentation addresses that need. Does that make sense? So we're going to talk about, so far we haven't talked about presentations at all. Hank?
Can the report be in PowerPoint format?
It would be easier if it was in a doc.
It's a document, but it's
okay.
PowerPoint.
That's okay.
I mean, it's all packed up and we use landscape instead of
That's okay. Yeah, that's okay.
Okay.
So we haven't really talked about presentations, but that's what we're going to talk about this week. So we have Erik Bruun here to be our presenter, and he's going to give you kind of some tips on what you might want to include in your presentation. But before he did that, I just wanted to give you the basics. Basically, everybody's going to have 3 minutes to present, so that's really not very much. And we're going to start by having, we're going to, at that April 12th, we're going to have an intro. It's 5 to 7 on April 12th. So we're going to have an intro and then presentations. So everybody's going to take a turn and each is going to be 3 minutes each. And then we're going to have awards where we're going to give you each 200 Berkshires. And then we're going to have a talk back, kind of like when you go to a play and the actors all sit on stage afterwards. So we're going to have a talk back where you guys all get to be up front, and it's not going to be like each of you is on the spot to answer questions, but we're going to have the audience ask all of you questions, and whoever feels like answering can. So somebody might say, what did you get out of this class? And then Keely says, well, I got this, and no, like maybe Michael doesn't have anything to say. He doesn't have to say anything. So those are the kind of pieces of it. And then there's also refreshments. So we're going to have cheese and crackers, and we're going to have donuts and cider and maybe coffee from Barth Anderson. So
any wine?
No wine, I don't think, but we'll have cider. So that's the outline of that event. So that way, I just wanted to give you that so you know what to expect. And can also tell your friends and people to come see it. So I guess, are there any questions about that? We're going to talk more, but yes, Joe?
should we be prepared to distribute the plan to people coming?
You can do that. So last year, we had some students who maybe they wanted clients. So they had a sign-up sheet in the back, like on a clipboard, where they could take people's emails and names down so that you could start a mailing list so that you could maybe reach potential customers. So you can do that. You can bring copies of your business plan if you want to hand it out to people. You can do that. So that's kind of what this time is for. It's to meet the public, so to speak. And you can do that in whatever way you want. If you have a prototype that you want to bring, you can do that. Like I'm not sure if he's gonna be here today, but he has a ping pong paddle. So if he was gonna present about ping pong paddles, he would wanna bring that to show. So you can have slideshows. If you wanna have a slideshow, let me know ahead of time so we can make sure that we have all the tech lined up to make it work. So you don't have to have a slideshow. Sometimes it's better not to, because people will focus on you. You can have prototypes. So last year, Elizabeth Orenstein presented about candles, hand-dipped candles, so she brought some with her so that people could see what they were like. Any other questions before we go on to the fun stuff? We can, if you have more questions, you can always ask me by email too. Okay. Well, I want to introduce Erik Bruun, who is our speaker. He's been a presenter here for 2 years before. He's the president of SoCo Creamery,
right,
and also a former journalist.
Yes.
Anything else?
Yeah, I once started a weekly newspaper.
Okay, and, so entrepreneur.
Entrepreneur, and I also started 2 nonprofits, Railroad Street. I was very involved in starting of 2 nonprofits, the Railroad Street Youth Project and Project Native.
So he's a nonprofit entrepreneur and a for-profit entrepreneur.
Yes.
Thanks for coming, Erik.
Thank you, Alex. So thank you for having me. what this class or this hour and 15 minutes that I'll be here will look like is I'm going to talk for about 10 or 15 minutes about what you should include, what you should think about when you put together a presentation. And what it is that, what are the 10 different things that an investor should know, and you should sort of look at those 10 different things and decide what are the most, if you only have 3 minutes, which would scare the daylights out of me, in terms of trying to tell a story in 3 minutes of something that could take a lifetime to really figure out and make successful. You have to really concentrate on what's the most important part of what I'm presenting, what's the most compelling, and what's the part that will draw the most interest. The most important thing, whenever you make a presentation on anything, whether you're writing a paper or standing up here like I am now, is to recognize that there's someone else, someone is listening to your story. And you want to tell your, you want to give your presentation as if it's a story. And that it's a story that the listener can connect to. So always bear that in mind. It's easy to get sort of caught up in your own sense of importance and the importance of what you're doing, but always bear in mind when you write something, there's someone else reading it, and you want to respect that reader, and you want to respect the person who's listening to what you're presenting. That's like my umbrella view is whenever you make a presentation. So I'm going to talk for another 10 or 15 minutes, and then I'm going to turn it over to each of you entrepreneurs to do a practice run through. You're going to be put on the spot to take your idea and stand up here and write on the board, and I'm about to hand out some what those 10 things are, and to sort of just talk through those 10 different elements of your idea. So
when you said the most important thing, the most compelling thing?
Yeah, what are the most important things? What's the most important information to convey? What's the most compelling in terms of what the idea is? What's the most compelling for the listener to want to get involved in it, you know, participate in it? And then as I go through these 10, we can elaborate on different things, because there are parts of it, parts of what you want to think about in a presentation that can rise or fall in importance depending on what it is. So if you have one of the things I'm going to talk about is your team. Who's on your team? And if you have Bill Gates on your team and you have an idea for software, you put that high up in the presentation, because that's very important. It's a very compelling piece of information about why this might be a successful idea. If it's you and your cousin and they've never done anything before, that's important and interesting, but it's not the most important thing. Then the idea becomes the most important thing. So we'll go through that as I do this. So you take one and distribute. So I also want to know there, how many of you are students? Everyone who's a mentor, raise your hand. Okay, that's great. And those who are, I don't know, if you're students or entrepreneurs, I don't know how do you classify yourself?
Students is how I usually.
Okay, very good. Who student?
Or potential
student?
Entrepreneur.
Student? Okay, so each, starting with you, what's your name, and in a sentence or two, what's your idea? So I know what to do.
Okay.
All right, so what you want to think about when you make a presentation. The first thing is, what's the problem you are solving? Why is your idea a good idea in the context of the marketplace? And there are things, when I started this weekly newspaper, I thought the problem was that these particular towns needed a second voice, a second journalistic outlet for there to be community dialogue and information. And I thought that was really important, and that was the problem I was going to solve. That's an authentic problem, but not enough people shared my view that this was a problem, and some people did, but it didn't really make it a viable business, right? So you have to be clear in your own head. What's the problem or the reason for your business, your idea. There can be a lot of people who don't know that what the problem is, particularly when you get involved in technology. When they invented the laptop computer, most people didn't know that the lack of a laptop computer was a problem or a missing piece in the world. So you could have like some sort of vision about something that other people will say, what are you talking about? That doesn't make sense. But you can come up, you can create the demand either through the quality of the product or the story behind it. When I listened to the video last year, I used the pet rock as an example. In the 1970s, there was a fad called the pet rock. And you could go into the store and you could literally buy a rock. And it had a little story associated with it. And it was one of the best-selling items in the country at the time. You remember?
I was seeing
it. Yeah. So who knew that this was a problem, that people didn't have rocks that they could identify as a pet? So I'm going to go with the ping pong? Is that yours back there? So I don't know what if there's a special magic quality of your ping pong racket. Is there?
Well, it depends on the user, but yeah, you can. I mean, not necessarily.
It sounds like there could be, though.
There could be.
But yeah. You're making it. It's like locally made.
Well, no. The magic is that it's 100% made in the USA and it's
okay.
Local.
All right.
There's no other one out there that's made in a production sense.
Well, there are a lot of people doing ice cream that's environmentally sustainable, right? You want to do an environmentally sustainable ice cream shop. The notion of American-made, locally-made is something that people consider a need. Like, there's a demand for that sort of thing. So the problem, you might say, is that you could buy a ping pong racket, right? But it's made of from China with plastic from Cambodia, and the conditions of it are terrible, but this one has a particular quality, right? It's not only is it made here, but it's of local craftsmanship, and it's a statement about who you are as a person, right? So, then the next question is, what's the solution? Right? And the solution is tied to the problem. How are you solving that problem? Holistic coaching,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
There aren't enough holistic health coaches out there, and those that are out there are only doing, what's a method of holistic coaching health?
Well, like mine especially I want to work with like adrenal health and stuff. So
you want to work with what?
Adrenal health and stress reduction and stuff like that.
Okay, all right. So the other holistic coaches, they ramp up the stress, right? and you need someone out there who's reducing the stress, mm-hmm. Right? And your solution to the misapplication of holistic health is to come up with a better, different way of doing it that might work for certain people. All right, what's the business model? What are the mechanics of making your idea work and be financially sustainable, where you can make some money? So on something like the ice cream, you would want to, you know, I think it's self-explanatory. The problem is ice cream is a very messy product from an environmental standpoint. It's a huge carbon footprint, it's dairy. Dairy is terrible from an agricultural perspective, from an environmental perspective, and then it has to be frozen, and so it uses a lot of energy. So the environmental impact of ice cream is significant, and so you would, but it's also, the ways to resolve it can be costly. So the business model on how you're doing this is going to be important. What is it that makes that work, and how are you going to make it financially feasible? And it looks like Alice very conveniently has given you a document for this, right? You said the magic. I like that. Did you get that term from this class? Because
I think you asked what the magic was.
It's in here. So yeah. Did you read that here? No. That was interesting that you said, what's the magic, right? What is the underlying magic? What's the special sauce? What's the special technology? How is it that this is like going to be special? What is it that your approach is that's different that makes it like quite unique? So the lowering the stress is an example of that. The coffee shop. You may choose a particular kind of coffee, or it's free trade type coffee. If you wanted to do a gold mine, like the magic is you own property that has gold. All right. Does anyone have any questions so far? All right. How sales and marketing. You can have the best product in the world, but if nobody knows it exists, right, it's not going to do much good. You have to figure out how your customers are going to learn about your product and what's your strategy around that. Now, on these things, you're not going to have time in this 3 minutes to get every piece in here, and this is probably one that would not normally rise to the top unless you had something special about it. So on the ping pong racket, if a key element of your plan is to have a tournament of people using your racket versus the conventional racket, and this will show that your racket is measurably better than those other rackets, then your sales and marketing plan might go move up in the priority list of what you would talk about. All right, so you want to think about, as you're thinking about the presentation, what you have to have, basically, you have to have these two, right? Or you have to think very much about that, and you also have to have the business model. So up till now, these top four are the highest priority when you want to make the presentation. The rest are depending on what it is and how important it is to emphasize. But you have to have in your own head what is the sales and marketing plan if you have someone who's questioned. The more defined your idea is on all these elements, the better you're going to be able to convey your story. And think about it as conveying a story. Then competition. All right, competition is super important for any business. And you need to know who your competition is, what makes your product different, and how it has a competitive edge. That feeds back into the magic kind of thing. So you need to have a good sense of who the competition is and where you fit into that. SoCo is ice cream, super competitive. Super, super competitive. In terms, especially when you go to pints in stores. I mean, you go and you've got 40 different options. And you have to be aware of where you are in that. And you have to think in terms of, well, what makes you different? What makes you different? Gate scoping business. Okay, you're different. and it's a very novel and neat idea. And that has a certain magic to it that is, people will be drawn to that idea. You know, why is it that goats work in a way that lawnmowers don't, for example? What are the advantages and disadvantages of that? I imagine from a cost and sustainability perspective, it's also got great advantages. So you're also a great story. Someone, if you're for the owner of a property, and you can say, who's your landscaper? you can say, well, it's Billy and I don't know what's Nanny. Billy and Nanny are the ones. Uh-huh. That's the kind of thing where they can share with their friends, right? And so you know, so much now, particularly more so than ever, is in terms of the sales and marketing, is what does this product say about yourself? What is the customer, right? How is the customer using your product? How is using your product a statement about himself or herself? I'm sorry, Monica, photography. The ability to use you for, you know, this kind of thing is a statement about the values of the family, right? The importance of, was that my phone? Stuff? Maybe, yeah. I don't, it isn't my phone. I don't have a phone.
Vito's
sorry.
Texting.
He's tweeting.
Yeah.
So the family that engages you, right, to work with their child for photography is making a statement about their values, right? And so, and their values are around art or culture or their child and, you know, being a thoughtful person. So you want to think about that in terms of your competitive advantage, in terms of competition.
Okay. Bring milk.
What's that?
No, it says Vito has to bring milk.
Team. Who is on your team? I mentioned this before. If, you know, on your team, Megan, you'll want to have goats, right?
Yeah.
And if your goats have special qualities, you want to talk about the special qualities of those goats. Chances are most goats don't have particular special qualities, do they?
No.
No. Okay. So you know, the fact that they're goats in and of themselves is not there. Now, there may be a world-renowned goat trainer, right, who's your partner. And you would want to make sure that that's up there, right? That if there's, there probably isn't, but if there is, or if you're associated around here with something like Ross and Brook Farm or something like that where people know about the goats and you're with someone who's there, that is a way of giving yourself credibility. So the people on your team can give you credibility for making this presentation. Does that make sense? All right, timeline. This is most likely not high on a list that you would want to get in your 3-minute presentation, but it's really important you know what it is, because the more you know what it is, the more competent you will seem to your potential investor, right? Yes?
Could I just ask a question about team members?
Yeah.
Would our mentors be considered our team members?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Yeah, that could be, yeah. That's your team is whoever's involved in it. It could be an investor, mm-hmm. It could be another wellness coach.
Yeah.
It's whoever gives you credibility. Because when you make a presentation to someone who doesn't know you, they don't know who you are. Mm-hmm. All you've got is this 3 minutes, and you want to just convey yourself as being credible, as being smart, as being thoughtful, and committed, and determined. You know, Vito asked me, why was Rare Street Youth Project successful? You know, why did we make it successful? And I would say it was because we were determined. We were really determined, and I would say, the likelihood of being successful in a business is much more a function of your own determination, your own drive, than the quality of the idea. My experience is a good idea with fabulous determination will always be a great idea with lukewarm determination. So if you've got the drive, that's what's going to make the difference in being successful. It's your own inner drive. There's other factors, luck, circumstance, the quality of the product, but if you're just determined to make it work. I mean, with the mentors, do people, do you all agree with that analysis?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And the ability to fail at part of it and to regroup and start over again.
Yeah, I mean, Vince Lombardi, the most famous football coach in the world, used to say, the mark of a champion is not whether you fall, but whether you get back up again, because you are going to fall. I mean, it's just going to happen. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to trip, and it's getting back up, learning from your mistake, maybe not even learning, but getting back up and doing it again, and eventually learning from it. Because making mistakes is a lifelong practice.
And then turning to your mentors or turning to people to help you also is part of that learning process. So it's good to include them in the team.
Yeah, or help you work it through it. I mean, the best mentor sort of explores the reasons and may not necessarily outright tell unless it has to be, you know? You draw it out, you know? We learn our lessons from our own sort of Socratic adventure, internal adventure, just like a dialogue. And the other thing I meant to say in the beginning is I really want to congratulate each of you entrepreneurs for having the courage to have an idea and pursue it. I mean, our lives have different elements in our lives prevail, and when you're younger, risk-taking, we're sort of designed to take greater risks when we're young. And you can take self-destructive risks that involve a lot of self-destruction, or the risk of it, and you can take risks that have a lot of constructive potential outcomes, and you are taking constructive risks, and that is in many ways much scarier and more intimidating in our society than the other, because you're saying, I want to do something constructive and make something of myself, and to fail, the risk of failing of that or feeling like you failed is high. It's higher than taking a risk that has self-destruction associated with it. So the fact that you have all these mentors here working with you is like we all understand that, and we all want to be there to support you through it, and not to tell you what to do, but to help you as you struggle with it. And it's important that we let you struggle with it, because in that struggle is where the learning happens. Okay? That's not on the 10, but that's just fine. That's the 11. Use of funds. It's important that you know how much money is involved in what you're doing, especially if you're talking to an investor. I don't know if it's important for this presentation, but it's important if you talk to an investor that that you have a sense of how much money you need for a restaurant. You know, what's involved in doing a restaurant? You know, you gotta have a kitchen, you gotta have staff. That's a much higher level of investment than probably the holistic health coaching. Mm-hmm. You know? Or the affordable artwork, you know, that's probably not as much of an investment unless you want to do it in a particular building. But you want to have a sense of what's involved in that effort. You know, are you going to want to have to purchase a gallery? Do you want to get money to buy that space, or are you just going to sort of peddle it in a knapsack? You know. Then the last thing is summary and call to action. What does that mean? It's what is it you're asking for? What is it that you're hoping the person you're talking to will come back to you with? So if what you want or need is $1 million, right, you ask for money. If what you want or need is a place to hold the goats, and you're talking to a person who has a farm that can host the goats, that's what you're asking for. Wanting someone who can help be your sponsor or mentor or guide, that's what you're asking for. But know your audience and know what it is that you seek from that person or group of people. And I think on this, on 2 weeks from now, what you're doing is presenting what it is, and you're probably looking for a sort of a broad sense of what are you asking for. Last year there was a young woman who wanted to do an all-natural
2 years
ago.
And so I offered to her, you know, we have a commercial kitchen, if she wanted, she could work with us. So you're talking to a broad audience, you know who it is, so what that specific ask is not so important. It's a broader one for 2 weeks from now. But in the future, when and if you make that actual presentation, know what it is that you're asking for. So the clearer you are in what the problem is, what the solution is, what makes you different, how you're going to do it, and what it is you want from that person, the better your presentation will be. Okay? I think that's all I have to say.